Now, with alert level one, Secretary, do you believe that our health care, the facilities that we have, the bed, the number of beds that we have, in other words, we're prepared in case of a possible increase in number or a surge, even if it's Omicron-related cases only?
But you see, we are prepared for the worst case scenario. Before we decided to de-escalate, we made an analysis of the capacity of the healthcare system of the country, no? Regionally and locally, yung provincial, mga cities, etc. So what we have observed, in fact, during the worst of the surges, the Delta one, ano, ang taas ng ating healthcare utilization rate and ang taas, tumutok din yung ating ICU bed utilization rate, yung severe critical cases were extraordinarily high. But we were able to manage it. So that was the litmus test, that I would say acid test that we were able to get over. So now with Omicron, that even tumaas yung Omicron yung cases, pero nakita naman natin, evidence-based, no? Ang baba, relatively speaking, yung severe critical and ICU utilization rate. Even total bed utilization rate was low. And continues to be low.
Uh-oh. Okay. Now, presidential aspirant Senator Panfilo Lacson and Senate President Tito Soto have asked, where's the COVID-19 transition plan? May plano po ba on transferring from pandemic to endemic? What's the transition plan?
Yeah, meron tayong plano. In fact, last week, we had met about two or three times together with NEDA and the IATF principals. No? The transition plan will be finished by hopefully mid next week. So let's wait for that. Dahil doon malinaw yung what we call the new normal roadmap.
Okay.
So this is something that we will launch as soon as all the inputs from the different sectors have been submitted. Kasi hindi naman ito madaling gawin. Ano? This is really a map, very comprehensive, yung shifting to the new normal. And realizing, of course, that we will live with the virus, I think that is an important philosophical underpinning, no? That the virus will be here to stay. So we will have to learn to live with it. Mm-hmm. Now, if the question is, will there no longer be surges in the future? No, we cannot say that. In fact, part of the realization is that there can still be surges, but are we ready to manage? Yes, the fact that we have already adopted the alert leveling system, I think it's a very good practice. We need to institutionalize that so that we already know for every escalation to a higher level, there's already a set of measures or interventions readily implementable. Whether it's going up or it's going down, alam mo na yung set of measures.
Uh-oh. Okay, Secretary, broad strokes, what will the transition plan include? I mean, clearly NEDA would NEDA would have specific points regarding how to boost the economy. But what would the transition plan detail, for example, aspects on what?
Well, you know, I don't want to preempt the entirety of the roadmap, no? The transition plan. So let's just wait until next week. And once it's out, we can more intelligently discuss this and really focus on the particulars of the transition plan. But for now, I don't think it's good for me to say anything about it, even on a broad stroke basis. But suffice it to say that the targets kasi are important. There has to be a set of targets spanning, you know, the public health, security, economy. Mm-hmm. There will be targets for each of those major components of the...
Okay. Yeah. Dr. Ted Erbosa said we are shifting from, let's say, government contact tracing to technically self-contact tracing, in effect, right? This is self-regulation. Pag meron kang sakit, pakiramdam mo may sakit ka, na tama naman. Huwag ka na lang lumabas, magpahinga ka ng 7 days, 1 week, a certain number, and then you make the responsibility, you inform people that you've seen that you are positive with COVID. So ang tanong ko nito sa transition plan, basics, Secretary. Number one, the cost of testing. Inirereklamo to ng maraming Pilipino. Sa ibang bansa, ang mura-mura ng antigen test, kahit ang RT-PCR mas mura kesa sa Pilipinas. Will this be included in the transition plan?
Well, yes. In fact, even ahead of the transition plan, we already have a process of reviewing the RT-PCR testing fees, no, or charges. And we have already gone, I think, one or two rounds of price adjustments from the start since 2020. So a third one should easily be in order to see. Yan naman kasi, depende rin yan sa supply. Ngayon, marami ng supplies, marami ng gumagawa. So dapat naturally, bababa talaga dapat ang presyo. And also the demand may no longer be as high as it used to be during the Alpha, Beta, and the Delta surges.
Will the government impose a cap? Because let's say now home service is still at 3.5, may naniningil pa ng 5, merong 4. So it seems to be that kahit papaano, there's still a free market set up with testing. Will you be putting a cap on that, Secretary, before you leave office?
Yeah, I think that's one of the considerations, Karen. No? So we will have to just rush this, no? Because we are on a countdown towards the end of this administration. And those are what I would call the low-hanging fruits, no? That we should really provide our people, no? With more affordable testing fees and without sacrificing, of course, the quality of the results. Okay. So it's very important that the accuracy is top of mind.
Uh-oh. Another criticism against the DOH, we're moving to a transition plan. Ngayon lang daw nagbibigay ang DOH, hindi pa nga sigurado kung lahat and where to access this, itong Kalinga kits po ninyo. In other words, kung mahirap po ako, nagkaroon ako ng COVID, pwede naman ako mag-home care, pero dapat libre na. Diba? Ang vitamina, ang gamot doon, kung kailangan ko po ng Zithromax or antibiotics. Pero sa ngayon, hindi pa po ganun ang setup. So Secretary, ano pong plano doon?
Well, yung Kalinga kits, no, this was conceived by the Department of Health. But the intention was really to spur the local government units to follow suit. So that's why I have gone around to witness and to provide these Kalinga kits with a complementation of the Kalinga kits coming from the DOH together with the local government units. So ang Cavite, ang Quezon City, ang Mandaluyong, and many, many other LGUs have already started adopting the Kalinga kit concept, especially in during home isolation or home quarantine.
Yeah. So what you're trying to say is, it technically speaking, in the long run, it's the LGUs that are supposed to give it out, not the DOH central office.
Exactly. Exactly, Karen. You know, the health, most of the health services have been devolved to the local government units. So kami technical support, and where there is a slack or a gap, then we try to fill it up on a temporary basis until the LGU is able to provide adequate supplies of these Kalinga kits.
Okay. Senator Soto and Lacson have said, I'm sorry to say this, and this is the exact quote, but many have said our weakest link in this pandemic is our healthcare program. What is your response to that?
Well, I think on the contrary, Karen, you know, We are fortunate that we have probably one of the lowest number of lives lost during this pandemic, given our scarce limited resources. No? If you look at the United States, the most powerful country in the world, has lost 1 million American lives. No? And we're nowhere close to that. So I think if there is one metric that we ought to be measured against, no, I think it should be the least lives lost is number one. Number two, the quality of the healthcare that has been provided by our frontliners, the healthcare workers, and I salute and honor all our doctors, you see, our nurses, our lab techs, med techs, everybody that has contributed into our pandemic response. And and also the vaccinators, you know, we have now vaccinated more than half of the country's population. In fact,
65 we're 70%.
Million. Yes, we have 70% of the target. Million. Right. 70% of the target population of 90 million. That's about 63 million fully vaccinated. So, of course, you know, there will always be the other side who will never stop complaining. No, in fact, gumaganda nga tayo. Wala naman nagko-compliment sa atin. Maganda yung atin numbers, ano, yung atin metrics, gumaganda. But you hardly hear anyone complimenting government efforts, no? Pero pagka may konting gap, yun, palalakihin yun. And sayang naman, let's start also acknowledging those who have sacrificed, those who have really put their heart into this pandemic response. And first and foremost, all of our healthcare workers, all of our health frontliners, no? From the national to the local to the private sector, everybody, you know. So I think the program, the health program of government, given the scarce resources, is, I think, has fared pretty well.
Okay, if that's the case, I mean, I know you've had supply issues in the beginning. Of course, two years ago, or maybe a year ago, the vaccine supply was the bigger issue. But considering these numbers that you had just stated, then why do you think, Secretary, like in the latest Bloomberg COVID resilience ranking, the Philippines of 53 countries, it was measured based on their response to Omicron. Bakit palagay po ninyo ay ganito pa rin ang bilang natin sa Bloomberg COVID resilience ranking, sir?
But una-una, Karen, hindi ko pa nakikita ito because we have been very busy with our de-escalation efforts, no? But by and large, kung titignan mo yung mga indicators, yung atin na COVID 19 metrics, as I've said, ngayon nga, tayo lang may pinakamababa na bilang ng active cases among the ASEAN countries. No? It's very easy to validate that. Look at the world in data, no? Sa WHO. And then, yung ating case fatality rate is low at 1.54, even lower for Omicron, less than 1%. No? Kung titingnan mo yung Omicron deaths natin, it's less than 1%. And then our deaths per million yung is what, about 500. It's one of the lowest. Yung iba as 30,000-40,000, you know, so huge a difference, no? But the economic metrics, yun naman ay tinitingnan din natin dahil yung GDP growth rate naman natin, fourth quarter was 7.7 last year, and the entire year was like 5.6% growth in gross domestic product, no? So I will have to look at where Bloomberg is coming from. Meron kasi more granular metrics na ginamit. Pati yung pagbiyahe, pagbukas sa international travel, etc.
Just to balance the conversation, to be fair to the country, the Philippines ranks at 50, but you have Hong Kong that's at 52. So kumbaga in the Bloomberg COVID resilience ranking, the latest, mas mababa pa ang Hong Kong sa atin. At kabilang sa metrics na nga ito is, there's the lockdown severity. We're in the Philippines, number 78. So is this one of the reasons why, Secretary, mag-alert level 1 tayo? Kumbaga, it's time to get, we will be out of lockdowns already?
No, yung lockdown natin, andyan pa yan, it's a component of our alert leveling system. So meron lang tayo, instead of widespread community lockdowns, hindi gaya natin, no, nung kasagsagan, nung unang pumasok ang COVID March 2020, we put the entire Luzon, no, in a lockdown. Ngayon, ginawa na natin, nag-shift tayo to granular lockdowns, no? Targeted response, early detection, and targeted response. One of these is the granular lockdown. So, mas focus. So, hindi nadidiskarel yung buong ekonomiya nung isang lugar, ano? So, it's targeted, and we will continue to adapt this measure if and when the metrics call for it. So kung nagkaroon ng surge sa isang lugar, tumaas ang infection rate sa isang lugar, doon lang tayo magla-lockdown.
So just for the record, kahit alert level 1 na, posibleng mag-impose pa ng granular lockdowns.
Oh yes, of course. That's
so
part
sino
of
na
it.
Po ito? IATF pa rin ba o mayor na lang po ito?
Well, actually, syempre, ang mga LGUs will always seek the guidance of the IATF, and which in turn, our panel of experts feed information into the decision-making process of IATF. Mm-hmm. So, but structurally, pwede na, yun ang LGUs. Kaya na nilang gawin yan kasi after 2 years, they've mastered it, Karen. You know? So, that is best left to them. And in fact, the authority to declare the lockdowns is lodged with the regional interagency task force, no? So yung mga local chief executives na ang magde-declare yan.
Okay, let's talk about the pediatric vaccinations. Before we proceed to that, what's interesting is Public Attorney's Office Chief Presida Acosta, I think, has filed a case, no, against you, including Undersecretary Vergere. So a Quezon City Court judge has ordered you both for a video conference. And I believe that was maybe last Tuesday or 2 Tuesdays ago. Ang tanong ko, anong nangyari po doon?
Well, tuloy-tuloy yan. It's ongoing. Yeah, I cannot comment because that is, you know, I have to invoke the principle of sub judice. Mm-mm. So let us just wait until a decision has been made. Kasi they filed for a TRO.
Yeah.
But I think the TRO was not given. So whether this will ripen into a full-blown case, that is something that we need to wait for.
And the pediatric vaccinations, can you give me the latest numbers? Secretary, yeah, if you have them with you.
Yeah, the pediatric vaccination for 5 to 11, we have about 736,000 children vaccinated. And then for the adolescent, 12 to 17, we have about 9.2 million vaccinated as of February 28th. So that's 80% more or less of our targeted population of 11.4 million pediatric group 12 to 17 years. Pero yung mababa pa rin natin, Karen, yung doon sa 5 to 11 natin, we have a total target population of 14 million. More or less, and then doon sa coverage natin is about 5.09%.
And what challenge?
Kasi wala pang second dose eh, kasi bago pa lang eh.
Okay, yung pediatric vaccinations will also have 2 doses of its own formula. Pero okay, 2 quick questions on that, no? Pinag-uusapan po ba sa IATF? Number 1, to have mandatory vaccinations for teachers? Yan ang una kong tanong. Kasi ang hirap mag-face-to-face classes to go back to the new normal if may certain sectors who are not vaccinated or refuse. So I'm sure with healthcare workers, while it is not mandatory, the number, the percentage is big. Paano po sa teachers, Secretary? Pinag-usapan po ba ito?
Ah, yes, paano yan? Pinag-uusapan nga yan. In fact, in some of our IATF meetings, si Secretary Liling Briones has been very, very, frank about it. No, na malaking problema kung may mga teachers na anti-vaxxers, ayaw magpabakuna. So, yan naman ay tinitingnan na natin. But slowly, I think the numbers improving. More and more teachers are wanting to have themselves vaccinated. In fact, if you look at the SWS, hesitancy rate has gone down from a high of 36% in May to 8% in the recent run of the SWS. No? So I think that's a good indication or a sign that people are already now increasingly believe in the protection that the vaccines provide and that they ought to take advantage of this. And that that's why I think media also has a big role to play here, no? To peddle science, evidence-based protection that vaccines provide. And our policy, in fact, of a vaccine portfolio, yung marami tayong klase mga bakunang kinukuha, ay maganda kasi lahat na kukumpara din natin itong mga bakuna. So far, all of them are very effective in protecting against severe and critical COVID infection and therefore preventing hospitalization and deaths.
Okay. And very quickly, what about young students? No? I mean, teenagers, but that's a whole other group. But the 5 to 11, for example, have you spoken about it sa IATF? Na let's say, pag hindi bakunado, online lang siya. Pag bakunado, dun lang siya pwede mag face-to-face. Because I think transitioning to the new normal, this is where the concern goes. What happens to our students? Medyo huli na tayo, Secretary.
Yeah, unang-una, ang DepEd has the final say on this, no? With, of course, the agreement that the local government unit will support and that the parental consent is given, you know? But right now, the challenge that we need to hurdle is the supply of vaccines for the pediatric age group 5 to 11 years of age. Yun ang medyo mabagal.
Yes.
We only have so far 2.1 million doses received, no?
And, so what do you intend to do there, Secretary?
Well, we've been following up. I and the team of Secretary Galvez and Secretary Dizon has already made representations with Pfizer because it's only the Pfizer vaccine that has an EUA for this age group. So we're hurrying it up because there's the demand is so great, no? But ang problema is the supply. Kaya titira mo, mababa. Yeah.
So ngayon, supply ang issue for the pediatric jabs.
Exactly. Exactly.
So is it fair to say walang supply ngayon?
Kakaunti, very limited. Very limited. Dumarating lang, 700,000 doses. It's not even hitting 1 million in terms of bulk deliveries. Ang baba.
Oo. Okay. And to clarify, also, is there's a change in the method to get your booster shots? Dr. Herbosa announced yesterday that the big drug stores already have booster shots and you can go there. Just bring your vaccination card. Tama ba ito, Secretary? Saan pa ba meron? You don't have to be a resident of that area.
That is correct. It's part of our expansion program that we launched about last month, no? Early February. And ito yung tinatawag natin, res bakuna sa butika. So all 18 years old and above can receive booster shots in said pharmacies, boutiques, spread across the country. And let me just mention some of them. and I hope it's not improper. Yeah. No? So please, we have Mercury Drugstore, we have Watson's, we have Generics Pharmacy, Generica, South Star, and many other, even local drugstores, no, and boutiques, no. So they have embraced quite well this Res Bacuna sa Butika, and it is a very, very good innovation that the National Vaccine Operations Center has introduced to precisely increase our vaccination coverage and hopefully reach 90 million Filipinos by the end of President Duterte's administration.
Okay, interesting. So the president is in office. Let's put it to maybe just a few more months, 4 more months. Tama ito, Secretary, no?
Yes.
4 months. So what is your target, the administration's target, for vaccination coverage before he leaves office?
90 million Filipinos is the goal, no? And right now we have given 63 million Filipinos their complete jabs. And so that's about 70% of 90 million. So we still have 20% or about 20 million Filipinos. That would be roughly 40 million doses remaining in 4 months time within which we should be able to accomplish that.
Before you leave office, I mean, you've had a rough ride. You've had many lawmakers calling for your resignation, but the president has stood behind you. What would you personally want to achieve before you leave office?
Ako, two things, no? Personally, of course, to get out of this pandemic and really usher in the new normal. Okay, that's one. And I'd like to be remembered also, and my team, of course, as the ones that led this pandemic response, yielding with the least number of lives lost, 55,000. But of course, every life loss is irreplaceable, no? But we have to put this in context, no? Given our very limited resources, I think we did fairly well. Of course, our recovery rate, my target is more than 99% recovery rate by the end of our administration. Mm-hmm. And of course, the universal healthcare provisions, we hope that we would have made a dent in the implementation of this law, which reflects the aspirations of our people for a truly genuine universal healthcare.
Okay, you've mentioned 2 points, and what's sad is the first point you mentioned. It seems that the DOH, and not just you personally, but other members of the cabinet, will be remembered more for formally. I mean, I'm sure you've heard this, right? So there might be court cases after your term. How do you feel about that? That, in other words, in the midst of the pandemic, it's formally.
Well, you know, all of these will have to be cleared in the proper court of competent jurisdiction, okay? So we will we continue to trust in the justice system of this country and that everybody will be given accorded due process. And I am confident that we will be cleared because in the first place, as I have said time and again, we had nothing to do with the procurement process of the PSDBM.
Do you regret that? Do you regret trusting Christopher Lau moving the funds, $45 billion, to PSDBM to procure?
No, it's not trusting personalities, Karen. It's trusting the institution. So I trusted the PSDBM because this is directly an attached agency of the Department of Budget and Management, which is the department that by law helps the entire bureaucracy plan its budget, execute its budget, and make recommendations to Congress for its approval. So it's an institutional trust more than a personal trust.
Mm. But would you consider that a regret, Secretary?
Well, I have not done anything wrong, so there's nothing to regret because it depends on your perspective. For us, we were able to get the PPEs in place, and because of this, we were able to protect lives, and which is to me the most important of our healthcare workers, because they are a major pillar of the pandemic response. And the fact that we had a manageable, healthcare workers that got hit with COVID is a testament that the protection that these supplies have given was realized. No? So no regrets, kasi ang dami naman natin na save na buhay ng mga healthcare workers natin. So okay. There's not regret. No?
Okay, another question. The universal healthcare law passed, under this administration, but some have said it's a failure kasi walang pondo. So let's talk about that. Pag alis po ninyo, kumbaga hindi naman po ang sinasabi implementable on the ground.
The law is very clear. It has 10 years to implement and to assess or evaluate the impact, and also using certain objective metrics, no? Then that's the time we will be able to say whether the implementation was a failure or not. But syempre, you have to put it in the context of the pandemic. And there has been a setback, whether we like it or not, no? In terms of a more vigorous implementation of the universal healthcare law. However, let me just clearly state that because of the pandemic, meron upside, because it was able to catalyze or facilitated the implementation of very important public health programs. Okay, I'll mention to you one. The the epidemiology and surveillance units, lumakas yan, no? From the national to the regions to the provinces, cities, municipalities, because of pandemic. Okay. Number two, collaboration with the local chief executives, and unprecedented that we almost always met every week, twice a week. Talagang we were guiding them, and that they were very supportive of the IATF policies and resolutions. And then, of course, number three, yung ating procurement supply chain, which also tremendously improved. Imagine, we were able to manage, almost 240 million doses of vaccines. Unprecedented yan. That is history. Dati, puro skwala kami. Measles vaccine, polio vaccine, kakaunti lang yung mga yan, no? Pero ito talaga by the hundreds of millions of vaccines, no? So yan pa yung mga of course, ito yung largest vaccination program natin that was ever initiated by government in the entire history of the health sector, and in particular of the DOH, no? Okay. So marami tayong nagawa. So yung pandemic response, yung emergency disaster risk response, no? And then also very importantly, the setting up of the patient navigation and referral system to our one.
So what you're saying is all of this, at the very least, were success stories under the Universal Healthcare Act.
Yes, that is correct, Karen. And in fact, even the alert leveling system, I firmly believe this is a very good practice that that is worth institutionalizing. Okay. So a lot of these, some provisions of the universal, not all, but some. But hey, the law gives us 10 years, diba? The integration of the local health systems, for example, into province and citywide health systems. With, of course, financing, sustainable financing coming from the Philippine Health, from PhilHealth, complementing the health budgets from the General Appropriations Act. So marami tayong mga pwedeng gawin pa. At the next administration is fortunate because we have paved the way for a much better health system, because of our deep and broad pandemic response experience.
But although the next administration is also inheriting 11 trillion pesos in debt, let's also not forget that it's going to be very difficult.
The whole world is deep in debt, Karen. No, it's not as if we're just in this by ourselves, no, but it's the whole world. So what is important is we will be able to give the next administration a plan up for them to adopt this new normal roadmap, and a lot of good stories to tell, success stories and programs that we were able to get off the ground. Now, whether this is concluded, it's never concluded, because number one, you don't know if a new variant of concern is just around the corner. We don't know that, right? A lot of unknowns still. But in terms of responding, I think we can firmly say that which programs have worked and which programs are not to be continued. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of learning to be shared, a lot of learning that we have really benefited from. But the important thing is for the next administration to also benefit from all the good that this administration will leave behind.
Okay, my last question, just a quick response, please, with this. How would you describe your performance?
My performance? You know, I've never been personalistic about my performance. I've always considered my performance in the light of team effort. So it's number one, the IATF that I really commend because of their dedication and commitment, the endless meetings, the planning, the discussion.
Would you say, I mean, you could have done something better, or you did your best, or you're very good, you were excellent? What would it be? I mean, yeah, you all have personal metrics, right?
yeah, but different question. I have a discomfort answering that, because as I've said, it is really a team effort. It is the DOH, it's the IATF, and above all, it's the president who orchestrated all of this, no? And so his belief, his confidence, his trust in us was never unwavering, no? Was never in doubt. So that's why this is what, I mean, the numbers speak for themselves, Karen. So just look at the numbers, let people gauge us. I don't want to be gauging myself. Whether I could have done better, sure, I could have done better. But, you know, as I've said, nobody was prepared for this pandemic. You know, the whole world was brought down to its knees. But in a sense of our scarce resources, limited resources, I think we did fairly well.
On that note, Health Secretary Francisco Duque, thank you for joining me today, sir. You take care and good luck to you.
Keep well yourself, Karen. Thank you for your gracious invitation. Till the next time.
Thank you, Secretary.